The final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 24181 in the name of Rona Mackay on Eating Disorder Awareness Week 2021. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and can ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Rona Mackay to open the debate. Ms. Mackay, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to be leading this debate on eating disorders today during Eating Disorders Awareness Week, and I thank members from across the Chamber for supporting my motion. It's a subject we debate annually in this Parliament because we must promote awareness and update on the steps we're taking to tackle the devastation these conditions cause. Can I pay tribute to my colleague Emma Harper for leading this debate for the past few years, and I look forward to hearing her speak tonight. Presiding Officer, during this pandemic, much attention, rightly so, has been placed on issues involving mental health. We're all experiencing anxiety and stress like never before during this pandemic, and it can manifest itself in many different ways. The organisation BEAT is a renowned expert body in the field of research and campaigning for awareness and recognition of eating disorders, and I'd urge everyone to visit their website as it offers a wealth of information possible to really fully in a short debate like this tonight. BEAT tells us that in a survey of people with an eating disorder conducted during the first lockdown, 9 out of 10 respondents said that their symptoms had got worse as a result of the pandemic. One young woman said, "I was doing well, but I just know this is going to lead to a relapse and I'm terrified." Referrals for children and young people to eating disorder services in Scotland were rising significantly before the pandemic. Now they're rising even faster. Child and adolescent mental health services, CAMHS, are reporting unprecedented referral rates. Demand from Scotland to access BEAT support services was 283% higher in 2020 compared to 2019. Let that sink in for a moment. Clinicians across the country are reporting that far more patients are presenting at a stage where they are already severely ill or in crisis. Presiding Officer, eating disorders are serious mental illnesses. Around 1.25 million people in the UK suffer from one, and they affect people of any age, gender, ethnicity or background. They have major impacts on individuals, the NHS, social care and, of course, families. Presiding Officer, at this stage, I'd like to mention former MSP Dennis Robertson and his family. February 25th of this year was the 10th anniversary of the passing of Dennis's daughter Caroline from an eating disorder. I don't know Dennis, but colleagues tell me of his courage and dignity as his family went through one of the worst experiences most of us could ever imagine. Dennis held a members' debate in every year of the last Parliament. He also held 2 conferences on eating disorders in Parliament, bringing together families, clinicians and policymakers for the first time. I think we all know Caroline would be very proud of him. The thoughts of this Parliament and beyond are with you and your family, Dennis. Presiding Officer, the theme of this year's campaign is binge eating. This disorder will affect 1 in 50 of us in our lifetime, making it the most common, but perhaps the least understood, eating disorder. People with a binge eating disorder regularly feel out of control when they eat and feel distressed afterwards. And it isn't about being greedy or lacking in willpower. It's in fact a serious mental illness. It can affect anyone of any age, gender, ethnicity or background. In 2020, 30% of contacts from Scotland's BEAT helpline were about binge eating disorder. People with the disorder experience significant shame and often suffer alone without seeking help due to the fear of how others might react. And this is a prime example of how, if we are to achieve our vision to end the pain and suffering of eating disorders, we need to change the conversation about binge eating. We must challenge harmful stereotypes about the disorder so people living with a serious mental illness can find kindness and compassion when they bravely reach out for help. Presiding Officer, eating disorders can be fatal, cause serious physical health problems, and overall quality of life has been estimated to be as low as in symptomatic coronary heart disease or severe depression. Without early intervention, which is crucial, many people become unable to participate in education or employment. However, recovery is possible. Access to the right treatment and support is life-changing, and early intervention provides the best chance for recovery. That's why I welcome the announcement of £120 million for a Mental Health Recovery and Renewal Fund and the publication of the Mental Welfare Commission for Scotland report into the care, treatment and support for people with an eating disorder, which forms the foundation of a review of services. It has never been more needed. Because currently those who are able to access treatment experience an average 3.5 year gap between onset and the start of treatment due to delays in identification, referral and waiting times. And this is surely wrong. Provision of treatment for binge eating disorder is patchy in Scotland. Only 5 health boards provide specific treatment for under 18-year-olds with the condition. 11 health boards provide specific treatment for adults with binge eating disorder, much of which is offered through weight management services. Presiding officer, the Scottish Government and NHS Scotland Health Board should ensure that there's equitable access to evidence-based treatment for binge eating disorder. And I believe this should be a core part of the implementation for the Scottish Eating Disorder Service Review from 2021 onwards. Only 2 health boards in Scotland have specialist CAMHS eating disorder services. Services for children and adolescents sit within the generic CAMHS units for other health boards. 10 health boards reported having specialist adult eating disorder services. 1 health board has specialist eating disorder services across all ages. Research has shown that in many cases, intensive day patient and intensive home-based treatments can be as effective as inpatient admission. They're generally more acceptable to patients and their families. But despite these advantages, a BEAT Freedom of Information request found that 3 of the 11 mainland health boards in Scotland don't provide suitably intensive day or home-based treatments for patients of any age. This must be addressed urgently. Presiding officer, as we see light at the end of the tunnel and begin to see recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic, I would like sufferers of an eating disorder and their families to have the same optimism that eating disorders will get the attention, the resources and the treatment pathways in line with all other serious illnesses. For everyone suffering now and for those who suffered in the past, it is the very least we can do. I look forward to hearing other members' contributions and to the Minister summing up tonight. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Mackay. I call Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Brian Whittle. Mr Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I congratulate my colleague Rona Mackay for securing debating time on this important matter. In early March 2008, I led my own debate on eating disorders and the devastating impact they have on the 100,000 people in Scotland estimated to suffer from these illnesses, including undoubtedly many in secret. Today's debate presents us with an ideal opportunity to recognise the efforts of the people and organisations across Scotland who work hard to both raise awareness and treat eating disorders effectively. I also want to look at the progress made over the last 13 years. In 2008, I highlighted how Scotland trailed the rest of the Western world in the treatment of eating disorders. There were no specific advice for GPs, and only 2 private clinics in Edinburgh and Glasgow provided specialist care at a cost of around £3,000 per patient per week. I'm therefore heartened that in 2009, the first specialist adult NHS inpatient unit opened in Aberdeen, with a second opening in West Lothian 4 years later, while some specialist adult eating disorder NHS beds were also made available in Glasgow. And a number of services have been developed to provide alternatives to hospital admission or shorter admissions where possible, such as the anorexia nervosa intensive treatment teams in Lothian and Fife, the day programme in Aberdeen, a specialist team in Glasgow, and Connect Eating Disorders, a service for all children and young people with eating disorders in Glasgow and Clyde. Under 18s with eating disorders continue to be treated within general child and adolescent mental health care services, where clinician expertise and patient outcomes have been improved by the introduction of evidence-based family therapies. This is significant and important progress, not least because experts remind us that it's possible for all patients to make a full recovery from eating disorders. However, there is not one specific cure, and it is important that a diverse range of services are available to patients. And as Rona Mackay has just explained, the services can be patchy across the country. Unfortunately, this is not always the case when it comes to treating binge eating disorders, the theme of this week's Awareness Week. The eating disorder charity BEAT found that provision of treatment for binge eating disorder is still patchy in Scotland and that only 5 health boards provide specific treatment for under 18-year-olds with binge eating disorder. I'm hopeful that the record £120 million of funding for the Mental Health Recovery and Renewal Fund announced by the Minister will help to ensure there is more equitable access to evidence-based treatment for binge eating disorder. This should also be a core focus of the implementation for the Scottish Eating Disorder Service Review, designed to assess and improve support for people living with an eating disorder, which will be informed by the Mental Health Commission's first ever themed report on eating disorder services. Among other things, the Commission's report still sees opportunities to improve GP training and new and improved protocols to follow and monitor. And for example, only one third of GPs who responded to the Commission's questions said they were aware of integrated core pathways for services that look after people with eating disorders in their area. Presiding Officer, it's now more important than ever to have a full picture of the current system of support available for those with an eating disorder. The negative impact of the pandemic is evident through the scale of demand for many charities' services, including Beats, which is 283% higher in 2020 than the year before. We've come a long way since the 1990s, when there were no official inpatient or specialist services for people with eating disorders, and we've also made some significant progress on eating disorders over the last 13 years. And yet, the challenge we are facing is huge, exacerbated by the pandemic, not least in the prevention of eating disorders from arising in the first place. Going forward, we must ensure that resources made available by the Scottish Government for Mental Health will further improve services for people with eating disorders and support early intervention and community services. And I look forward to hearing the Minister's response to this debate in that regard. And I would like to thank again Rona Mackay for bringing this debate to the Chamber.
Thank you very much, Mr Gibson. I call Brian Whittle to be followed by Emma Harper. Mr Whittle, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I would like to add my congratulations to Rona Mackay for bringing this debate to the Chamber. I think it's a debate that's being revisited, but it's always well worth the attention that it receives. I think the last time I spoke on this topic, I did mention that I recognise that eating disorders are far more common than most of us recognise. I doubt there's many people within this chamber that doesn't know somebody who suffers, but I was quite interested to hear Rona Mackay suggesting that it's actually a disorder that is not very well understood. And it got me thinking back to, you know, where's my journey in understanding where eating disorders come back. So I'm going to throw a name to you here so the older ones in the chamber, and by that I mean obviously Kenny Gibson, might grab this. If you remember, a young lady called Lena Zavaroni, who won Opportunity Knocks with that fantastic big voice. And she's the first person I'd ever heard the word anorexia. And of course, she ended up dying from that condition. It's the first time I'd ever heard about it. And if I roll forward to my athletics career, I remember hearing it again when one of the distance runners, the female distance runners, that anorexia was attached to her. And it was one of those ones I could never quite understand. How could you possibly suffer from not eating enough and be an international class distance runner? And I can remember some of the language that coaches used to use back then. I remember a coach quite vehemently saying to one of his athletes to go away and don't come back until they've lost their weight, because they had a fat backside and sending them away and not allowing them to come back. So when I became took my coaching exams, one of the things that was brought to the fore in the sort of senior exam was the responsibility of a coach and the language that a coach would use when discussing these things with athletes. And that also must pertain to parents as well, and the language that we use with our children, because I think one of the biggest pressures that we have at the moment is an unrealistic expectation of the shape that we are supposed to be through some of the media and the social media. And that is without question. I've got three daughters of 10 years apart, so I can actually see the evolution of that whole debate. I think that is actually quite dangerous. So, as I said, it's all very well when it's far away and you're looking at it far away and it's other people, but when it comes into your own family, it is extraordinarily distressing. Somebody close to me, their own family, I discovered suffered from bulimia, which is obviously an overeating disorder. The pressure on them to conform to a societal shape had driven them towards bulimia. But as Rona Mackay indicates, I think it's a symptom of something else. It's a symptom of something else. And I think one of the key issues, I said, going back to Rona's words that said that it's the least understood, I think because it's one of those conditions that still has a serious state of stigma attached to it, and it tends to be a hidden condition. It is a mental health issue, and I think that's something that again, Rona Mackay said, that we're starting to get our heads around. And mental health through COVID, I saw a report that said that eating disorders had grown enormously through COVID, and they're treating eating disorders at a much higher rate now. And so when we come out the other side of COVID, we are going to have to be cognizant of the mental health services, both statutory services and third sector organisations, as I've spoken about before. Lastly, I think I said, I just want to say that we note that societies, as I said before, our expectations of what we need to look like is putting unrealistic pressures on our youngsters. And that is something I think that needs to be addressed. And as last, I'll just say thank you very much again to Rona Mackay for bringing this debate to the Chamber. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr Whittle. I'll now call Emma Harper. Ms Harper, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As co-convener of the Mental Health Cross-Party Group, I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate on Eating Disorders Awareness Week, with the theme of creating a future where people experiencing binge eating are met with understanding and compassion. And I welcome the attendance of representatives from BEAT, who have attended many of the recent Mental Health Cross-Party Groups and contributed well to the discussions. I congratulate my friend and colleague Rona Mackay on securing this debate, which I have had the opportunity to lead in previous years. And I want to associate myself with her comments about Dennis Robertson and his work on eating disorders and this year's 10th anniversary of the loss of his daughter Caroline. Presiding Officer, between 1.25 and 3.4 million people across the UK are currently living with an eating disorder of some type. And this is on the increase, including as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic restrictions. This has posed challenges for the delivery of treatment services for people at risk because of the additional stress which the pandemic has posed. Eating disorders vary from anorexia to bulimia and to another very dangerous eating disorder called diabulimia. Diabulimia occurs when people with type 1 diabetes deliberately omit their insulin to control their weight. And I congratulate Diabetes Scotland on their work on diabulimia and would encourage anyone interested to have a look at their advice and support. And Presiding Officer, I remind Chamber that I have type 1 diabetes. The theme of today's debate is binge eating. Binge eating is one of the eating disorders which is largely associated with stigma. Binge eating episodes can include eating much faster than normal, eating until feeling uncomfortably full, eating large amounts of food when not physically hungry, and eating alone through embarrassment. Presiding Officer, research carried out by universities, including UWS in my South Scotland region, continue to point to the relationship between social media and eating disorders, particularly amongst young people. Social media is great, and it can allow worldwide connections to be made, as well as the sharing of ideas, knowledge and information. The social media can also be a dangerous platform for hate, discrimination and shaming. Seeing dieting ads or frequently being exposed to images that may provoke body image concerns can be damaging and dangerous for some young people. These ads and posts may in some cases lead to young people developing an eating disorder and puts many others into an at-risk category. Social media interactions are often an extension of an adolescent's life. So being aware of online safety and the issues that young people today may be facing online is so important for families and friends. I would ask the Scottish Government to keep this in mind when overseeing the development of the proposed guidance on eating disorders. Last year, the Scottish Government announced that eating disorder services will be subject to a national review, designed to assess and improve support for people living with an eating disorder. The review is set to publish its findings in spring this year, and it has the aim of providing a full picture of the current support available for those with an eating disorder. It will then offer several recommendations to inform improvement work throughout the year. I ask that Eating Disorders Support also considers rural Scotland and to ensure that it is able to tackle social media issues. Presiding Officer, this week I learned that the dietetic team in NHS Dumfries and Galloway have specifically been working with those at risk of developing diabulimia amongst other eating disorders. And I was interested to hear that because of the rurality, D&G also has the ability to raise awareness of young people who might not be picked up or be reluctant to access support because of travel involved in rural appointments. Presiding Officer, the emphasis that the importance of ensuring support services for rural Scotland is something that I'm passionate about because of my rural South Scotland region. I welcome the debate today and congratulate Rona Mackay again for bringing it to Chamber this year. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Harper. Now call on Claire Hawkey to close for the Government Minister, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to respond on behalf of the Scottish Government. I believe this is the fourth debate I've spoken in Eating Disorders Week, both as a backbencher and as Minister for Mental Health, and I welcome this debate to mark Eating Disorder Awareness Week 2021. This debate allows us to raise awareness about eating disorders and the terrible impact that they have on not just those who are diagnosed, but their family and their friends too. And I too want to thank Rona Mackay for lodging the motion this year and for focusing our minds on how significant this subject is. It's now more important than ever that those who require help and support for disordered eating can receive the treatment that they need. The pandemic has not been easy on any of us, but there is growing evidence that people with eating disorders have been particularly impacted. I also want to pay tribute to our former colleague, Dennis Robertson. Dennis has continued to ensure that greater awareness is brought about around eating disorders, and I want to assure him that raising the profile of eating disorders is a priority for this government. And lastly, I want to extend my thanks to all of those across the country that work day in and day out to support the recovery of those with an eating disorder and their families. This is now more important than ever as we recover from the impact that the pandemic has had on services and on us as individuals too. This year's theme is binge eating disorder, and binge eating disorder is the most common eating disorder, but perhaps the least understood. It's a disorder that has unhelpful and damaging misconceptions attached to it, and we must challenge those misconceptions so that those living with this illness can feel confident to seek the help and support that they need. We know that the COVID-19 pandemic has had a substantial impact on the mental health of the population, and we have been through several stages of lockdown, recovery and restrictions. Each of these phases has had widespread impacts on people across the country, including those with diagnosed and undiagnosed eating disorders. And we know that eating disorders thrive in isolation, and that the earlier someone can access treatment, the better their chance of a full recovery. During the pandemic, there's been a focus on physical activity to stay healthy, and it's important to recognise that these messages, however well-intentioned, can cause serious harm to those suffering with an eating disorder. And that's why during the early stages of the pandemic, we provided BEAT, the UK's eating disorder charity, with funding to ensure that their online and telephone services were able to support as many people as possible during this difficult time. In addition to these services, we provided support through a new moderated online group, The Sanctuary, which focuses on supporting survivors with concerns relating to their eating disorder and COVID-19. And from this funding, BEAT supported over 4,000 people between April and November. Furthermore, we provided funding to deliver additional capacity to NHS Lothian and BEAT's national peer support services for young people with an eating disorder and their parents and carers. And through this funding, 150 young people were paired for peer support, resulting in over 2,300 emails being exchanged between them. And 48 carers were paired, resulting in over 600 phone calls. This type of support can be incredibly helpful for those impacted by an eating disorder. Knowing that someone feels the way that you do and that recovery is possible can be a lifeline. Digital and non-face-to-face methods of support have also become even more important over the last year, allowing us to stay connected and supported while staying safe. Last year, during Eating Disorder Awareness Week, I announced that we would take forward a national review of eating disorder services, which would build on the work of the Mental Welfare Commission's report, and we've heard several members mention that work. The review began its work last year and will continue its final report and recommendations, and will provide its final and report and recommendations to me at the end of this month. And this review is an important first step in a phased programme of work to improve the outcomes for people living with an eating disorder in Scotland. As I announced earlier today, the review's recommendations will be taken forward by an implementation group, which will be made up of relevant stakeholders who will take forward phase two of this vital work, including those who are experts by experience. As mentioned in our Mental Health Recovery and Transition Plan published in October last year, the review has also taken into account the effects of the pandemic on access to health and support. And the review will provide us with a specific recommendation on what support is required as we move towards recovery. Members will be aware that we recently announced £120 million for the Mental Health Recovery and Renewal Fund, which will prioritise our ongoing work to improve specialist CAM services, address long waiting times and clear list backlogs. And this funding will also provide significant additional support for mental health in primary care settings, and we will invest in enhanced community support too. And I want to reassure the members in the chamber and members of the public who may be watching that providing the right support for those with an eating disorder is a priority for this government. Members may also recall that 2 years ago I announced the production of new Scottish specific guidelines on the management and treatment of eating disorders. The Scottish Intercollegiate Guidelines Network, or SIGN, have been leading on this, and I'm pleased to say that they are due to be published later this year. And the guidelines will cover areas such as referrals, management of risk and transitions. And these guidelines, along with the review's work, will ensure that those who require support will receive it. Presiding Officer, I think the debate this evening has been really interesting. We've heard some really valuable and interesting contributions from across the chamber, from Kenneth Gibson talking about the evolution of services in Scotland. Brian Whittle gave us a really interesting personal reflection on his journey to recognising eating disorders and things that he could do personally as a coach to perhaps challenge that and raise awareness. But he also raised a really important point about stigma. And we all play a part in challenging stigma around all mental illnesses. And Emma Harper, who spoke passionately about diabulimia, and I know she's spoken about that in the chamber before in previous debates. Presiding Officer, I close by again thanking Rona Mackay for lodging the motion for this debate this evening. I also want to reiterate my support and thanks to the staff who have been working tirelessly throughout the last year to support those with eating disorders and their families. And I assure you that you have this government's full support.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.